Nightcast. Stephen Lloyd Gilbert brings you the current news from the world today and how it relates to Bible prophecy. Understanding the end time events leading to the peaceful world tomorrow. Ladies and gentlemen, Stephen Lloyd Gilbert.
Good evening, friends, and welcome to this June 10, 2015 edition of Nightcast. A cortege carrying coffins of Germans killed in German Wings plane. The German Wings plane crashed that the plane's co-pilot is believed to have deliberately crashed the Airbus A320 into the French Alps in March. And now here is a cortege of coffins of the school children who were killed that has arrived in their hometown of Haltern, Jenny Hill, has this opening report.
Past their classmates, past their school, the children of Haltern came home. 16 coffins, one for every life lost. It's 3 months since they set off on an exchange trip to Spain.
The parents had to wait a long time for this day to arrive, for their children to come back so they can bury them. These last 12 weeks have been a terrible time.
150 people died when the plane came down in the French Alps with this man at the controls. Co-pilot Andreas Lubitz suffered from severe depression and in the week before the crash researched suicide methods online. And here in Haltern, they'll tell you nothing will ever be the same. This is, after all, a small town.
It has affected us personally because two of the children were delivering papers for our journal. And it was very hard times because we know many of the parents, we know many of the families. And because of the strong sense of community in Haltern.
The first funerals will begin on Friday.
In the words of one man here, this is the day Haltern can begin to grieve. Their children are home. This town can bury its dead. Jenny Hill, BBC News, Haltern.
Your relatives of 44 of the 150 victims viewed their coffins inside a hangar at Dusseldorf Airport. Remains are to first be repatriated following delays over errors on the death certificates. Pilot Andreas Lubitz, as you heard in the video, is believed to have deliberately crashed the Airbus A320 into the French Alps in March. He was reported as being very depressed, and many of us who study religion understand and know that that can be a situation where a person becomes demon-possessed. And while Jesus Christ was here on earth, he was noted for one of the things of healing that he did would be to cast out demons when a person would have the afflictions that often accompany demon possession. Let's go to our next story, though. In the past week, several rockets have been fired at Israel from Gaza, endangering the 10-month ceasefire that ended last summer's deadly war. Yolande Nail has this report from Israel.
Gaza hasn't begun to recover from last year's devastating war with Israel. And now its residents and the Hamas authorities are facing a new threat from within. Ultra-conservative jihadists who support the Islamic State group. Early this year, the black flags of IS were on show at this protest against French cartoons of the Prophet Muhammad. Hamas allowed it to go ahead, wanting to show its own Islamist credentials. But recently, there have been confrontations. Extremists have been emboldened by IS gains elsewhere in the region.
We have the Salafi groups here in Gaza pledging their support to the Islamic State in Iraq. They very much resemble ISIS or Daesh in Iraq in terms of their ideology and in terms of their radical interpretations of Quran and Islamic law and Sharia.
Hamas blames IS for attacks on its security forces. They've made dozens of arrests, and last week they raided the home of a prominent activist and shot him dead.
Now tensions are running high in Gaza. Militants linked to Islamic State pledged revenge for what happened here. And in the past week, they fired rockets at Israel. Israel holds Hamas responsible, and it's hit back with airstrikes.
There are fears that IS could force a fragile ceasefire deal to collapse.
What they're trying to do, they're trying to challenge Israel and to challenge Hamas, because they know that once we'll see another missile attack or missile attacks on Israel coming from Gaza, Israel will have no other choice but to retaliate. And this is exactly what they want.
In Gaza City, boys join in this show of strength for Hamas. The movement has plenty of support, although it was weakened by last summer's fighting. At the moment, Islamic State has relatively few followers here, and yet its ability to provoke and pressure local leaders could be a worrying sign for the future. Yolande Nell, BBC News, Gaza.
Okay, friends, let me correct myself. I know some of you may have noticed I said that Yolande Nell would be reporting from Israel. You know, Gaza used to be part of Israel, so let me correct myself before some of you have a chance to fire emails off and Facebook notes at me to say, hey, you know, that was Gaza where she was, which is no longer technically Israel. Police in Egypt, friends, say that they have foiled an attempted suicide bomb attack. And this attack was staged or set to be to go off at the Temple of Karnak in Luxor, one of the country's most popular tourist sites. BBC's Arabic Mohammed Yahia explains.
Three men arrived at the car park outside, just outside this temple, and they came out of the car. They were holding bags. The police were suspicious, and one of them tried to run away, and then he detonated the bomb that he was carrying. The other two exchanged fire with the police. One of them was killed and the other was injured. The police are saying that they successfully thwarted an attack on the temple. They didn't manage to get inside the temple. But now is a low season for tourism in Luxor because the daytime temperatures there exceeds 40 degrees Celsius. But still, what is worrying for the Egyptian authorities is this is the second attack on a major touristic site in 1 week. Last Wednesday, there was a drive-by shooting at the famous Giza pyramids in Cairo, where two policemen were killed. So the authorities there are bracing for possible more attacks of similar nature, and they've said that they're bolstering security around this kind of important touristic sites. The number one suspect for this kind of attacks is Islamist militants. They have been doing such campaigns in the 90s, and since the ouster of the Muslim Brotherhood President Morsi in 2013, they've waged a semi-insurgency, mainly in the Sinai Peninsula, against security and army targets. But they've been gradually turning into mainland Egypt. But so far, they've been only targeting businesses and infrastructure like electricity pylons and railway lines. But if the two recent attacks today and last week could be seen as a shift in their tactics.
And friends, the attack today injured two policemen and two civilians. Now, the United States has confirmed it is sending an additional 450 troops to Iraq to help boost the training of government forces. President Obama made the decision following a request from Iraqi Prime Minister Haider al-Abadi. John Sopel reports from Washington.
The hitherto unseen secret command center in the Persian Gulf, where the round-the-clock campaign against Islamic State is being waged from. Here, U.S. military planners decide on which targets to hit and then watch in real time as the airstrikes are called in. The general in charge says that IS, or Daesh as they're known in Arabic, are feeling the pressure.
I think there's progress in the campaign in a whole range of places. We're starting to see Daesh see cover in terms of physically digging into positions.
But today's announcement from the White House, a recognition that IS is not feeling anything like enough pressure.
The strategy that we have discussed today in terms of ramping up our training and advising and assisting mission reflects the concern about the situation in Anbar province.
Until Mosul fell a year ago, America wasn't taking the threat of IS seriously. Across the Middle East, the policy goal was to disengage and bring American troops home. If the IS flag flying over Iraq's second city made US policymakers sit up, it was the brutal execution of the American journalist James Foley last August that galvanized the public here. Action was demanded, and it came. The evolving policy against Islamic State first envisaged there'd be no American boots on the ground. Then there were just 300 US troops to train Iraqi forces. Now there are 10 times that number. The president then announced that special forces would be deployed to hit high-value IS targets. And now, after the fall of Ramadi, the US is to increase the number of training camps and offer 450 more troops to improve the resilience of the Iraqi Defense Force. Until 3 months ago, this man was President Obama's chief advisor on the Middle East. In his first broadcast interview, he told me there are no easy answers.
It's clearly an admission that the progress that everyone wanted to see of building up an Iraqi army that would recruit Sunnis to work with it and start taking territory back from ISIS is not advancing. And, you know, obviously the fall of Ramadi was symbolic of that. By now, people had hoped to be working on retaking Mosul rather than losing some other city.
The aim is to bring Sunni tribes into the fight against IS, but it will mean the US trainers will be operating close to IS front lines, and that will present its own security concerns for the US and an opportunity for Islamic State to draw a reluctant America directly into the fight. John Sopel, BBC News, Washington.
Okay, friends, thank you. And more news that relates to the United States next. Friends, TTIP talks, or TTIP, you could call it. We'll explain that in a moment for those that may not understand what TTIP or TTIP is. MEPs in a bitter split on EU-US trade. And that's what TTIP or TTIP relates to, an EU-US trade deal. Now, UKIP, I'm going to call it UKIP, joined a chorus of criticism over the Parliament's handling of TTIP. Deep divisions have surfaced in the European Parliament over the EU's planned trade deal. You know, friends, I want to tell you, let me back up something, because I only have photographs with this. Let me put this photograph full screen while I tell you. The caption under this photograph says, UKIP, UKIP, joined a chorus of criticism over the Parliament's handling of TTIP, TTIP, that EU-US trade deal. Deep divisions have surfaced in the European Parliament over the EU's planned trade deal with the US. In a surprise move, Parliament President Martin Schulz decided to postpone a vote on the EU-US trade negotiations known as TTIP, TTIP. Then MEPs narrowly voted to postpone a debate on TTIP. UKIP leader and MEP Nigel Farage said the EU was running scared of public anxiety about TTIP. The Greens side also said the EU establishment was, quote, scared. Now, what is the EP, European Parliament, establishment scared of? Democracy? Citizens' concerns being raised? This was a tweet made by the Greens group. Mr. Schulz postponed the vote because more than 200 amendments had been tabled to a wide-ranging package of recommendations on TTIP. Those recommendations would feed into the European Commission's negotiations with U.S. trade officials. Now, TTIP stands for Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. TT, Transatlantic Trade, and IP, investment partnership. So I guess maybe instead of TTIP, I should really stick with what most reporters are probably going to call this TTIP, Transatlantic Trade, TT, and Investment Partnership, IP, TTIP. The European Commission estimates that by 2027, it could boost the size of the EU economy by 120 billion euros. That's the equivalent of 94 billion British pound sterlings or 152 billion Yankee dollars, U.S. dollars. And that's equal to 0.5% of GDP. A summit statement from the G7 leaders 2 days ago on Monday said, we will immediately accelerate work on all TTIP issues. Transatlantic Trade. IP. The leaders of the major industrialized democracies have hope to get a TTIP deal before the U.S. presidential election in November 2016. One of the thorniest TTIP issues is investor protection. There is widespread opposition to commercial arbitration panels called Investor State Dispute Settlement, ISDS, where firms can sue national governments. Sections of the center-left socialist S&D bloc took a tougher line on ISDS than the group's main negotiator, Bernd Lange. There have been big anti-TTIP demonstrations in Belgium, Germany, and some other parts of Europe. Critics say TTIP could weaken EU rules on working conditions and health services. Mr. Lange said he would use the postponement to, quote, work towards reaching a stable majority for the TTIP resolution. The recommendations now go back to the Parliament's Trade Committee for redrafting. It's due to meet again next week. And then our last story for tonight, friends, related to the fourth seal from the Book of Revelation, that fourth seal being depicted in Revelation by a pale horse whose rider is named Death. And the primary thing that Jesus Christ described about this horse in plain language in Matthew 24, Mark 13, and Luke 21 is loimos, as he said it in the Aramaic or Greek language, which means disease epidemic, pestilence, the plagues of Egypt. And our last story deals with that. Outbreak of MERS, M-E-R-S. The Middle East Respiratory Syndrome was claimed, is that virus that has claimed 9 lives in South Korea, and authorities are taking steps to curb the spread of the disease and reassure the public. Stephen Evans has this report from Korea.
It is the dead of night here in Seoul, and the wheels on the trains have stopped. Sensible people, pretty well the whole city, are at home in bed. And that means that important work can be done here. Initially, the means of transmission was hospitals. Sick people went to hospital and infected others. But now they're looking at much more complex routes, like the railway network. There are 9 million journeys on this network every day. And the authorities are very keen to stop the city being paralyzed and slowed down simply by fear. Normally, they disinfect these trains once a week, but now they're doing it every single day. That, of course, is about the chemical process of actually cleaning every single nook and cranny. But it's also about trying to reassure the public that these things are safe. And you do detect far fewer people wearing those masks now. No. So maybe the message is getting through. There are on every train 712 of these hanging straps and door handles, and it turns out that they are absolutely crucial to stopping this thing. It's the one place where somebody with MERS might go like that, and the next thing you know, maybe 100 people have touched it, and it's far and wide. So this work is absolutely crucial. So there's a great deal of invisible elbow grease being used to defeat this illness. It will only have worked, though, when the number of new cases falls to zero.
Friends, the bottom line of that story, or any story having to do with disease epidemics, comes down to a verse of scripture that an entire book was written about. This little book here, if you can see the title, I don't know if you can see that on your screen or not, but this little book, this is, it's kind of torn up. My cover page has already come loose from it. It was a book that we had in first year Bible at Ambassador College in Pasadena, California. The book is written by an MD, a medical doctor, a licensed medical doctor, S.I. Macmillan. He does a thorough job with the details that he puts in here, but what he's doing is supporting from an expert, from a medical expert's point of view, what God basically says in one scripture of the Bible, where God says, if you will obey me, just like in Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28, where God says, if you diligently hearken to my voice and obey my statutes, my commandments, my judgments, he says, he promises a whole list of blessings. And halfway through the chapter, he says, on the other hand, if you don't obey me, as Adam and Eve did not do, and as most of mankind really don't do, he says, just the opposite of those blessings, curses. Each one of them turned right upside down, you know, and instead of blessing you individually and as a nation with rain in due season, which means just the right amount of rain, no drought, no floods, you know, you'll get just the opposite of that. You'll get the droughts. You'll get the floods. And nationally, instead of making you the head, just the reverse. If you don't obey, I'll make you the tail. Instead of being the lender, if you don't obey, just the reverse. I'll make you the borrower. And on he goes, he gets to the enemy part of it. It says, if you obey me, 5 of you will chase 100, and 100 of you will put 10,000 to flight. Contrawise, if you continue to disobey and I put the curses on you, I multiply them 7 times. And if you still disobey me, then I will break the pride of your power. And then this verse, which based on that same principle that this book was written on, this little book again entitled None of These Diseases by S.I. Macmillan, comes from a verse in the Bible that's similar in principle, and it's saying, if you obey me, I will put none of these diseases on you. And the doctor, the good doctor here, has written an entire book on it with detail after detail that boils down, and he does cite the verse and give some, you know, I was trying to see if there's anything I could just. He says here on page 137, with my vast store of wisdom and experience, it does seem a pity not to use it all, but you knowest, Lord, that I want a few friends at the end. Let's see, where is he? What is he doing? I think he's putting a footnote on here. Well, I thought I had a good quote for you on that, but it is a good little book. But there is one scripture, if we all believed it and practices it, that says, if you will diligently hearken to the voice of the Eternal and obey His statutes, His commandments, His judgments, I will put none of these diseases upon you. Okay, I'm not going to read you that quote because he's rather blunt right there. He's telling about actual diseases that people get. And the bottom line of it boils down to, here are the answers. Back cover, he says, here are the answers to the diseases that plague mankind. Read these revealing chapters prescribed for the millions who generate their own sickness by damaging life habits. Those life habits he's talking about are those that run contrary to God's law. And he lists a few things here and says, it's not what you eat, it's what eats you. You're as old as your arteries, mud or stars, they have the devil to pay. None of these diseases reveals again what was first laid down centuries ago, how every man can have a truly healthier body and joyous peace of mind by following the Word of God. That's how he puts a conclusion on the very back cover of his little book. And that's the essence of it. These diseases we're seeing, friends, if we obey God, God says, I'll put none of these diseases on you. Contrawise, otherwise, what we're going to see is a situation where these seals that you see from the book of Revelation, God says, if you don't obey me, what's coming in prophecy is one-third of the people, of the modern-day descendants of Jacob, which two of the major ones happen to be the sons of Joseph, Manasseh in the United States, and Ephraim in the United Kingdom. God says that if we don't obey, we'll see the time of Jacob's trouble in the Great Tribulation. We'll see a time where one-third of the people of each of those countries are killed by the sword, one-third are killed by the second seal and the third seal. The second seal is the sword, so I just mentioned the one-third that are killed by the sword. Another third will be killed by the third and fourth seal, the black horse of famine, and the fourth seal, the fourth horse of disease epidemic. And then the final third will be taken captive, and the majority of those who are taken captive, a good 90% of them, will be killed. About 10% of those who are taken captive will be left alive to live on over into the world tomorrow. Many of those who... I've given details on that before. We'll be giving that again. I want to go ahead and wrap up for tonight. I got a 15-second thing. I want to just maybe close with this to end on something light. We just gave you a story that should give all of us something good we can get on our knees about tonight. Give God a little bit of thanks even that disease epidemics, they've been able to retard it by doing a big cleanup there. But when it really hits and starts to spread, and God intends for that to happen in the nations of the modern-day descendants of Jacob, when he says one-third of you will die by famine and disease epidemic, it'll be so rampant you will not be able to stop it by any means whatsoever. No matter how thorough you try to clean, you won't even have the cleaning agents available to you once the attacks are made on the country, as will likely happen in order for that prophecy to be fulfilled. But I want to tell you something the BBC is doing and that I'm going to be keeping an eye out for and maybe using some during our programs in the days and weeks ahead. The BBC pop-up team, P-O-P-U-P, pop-up, has arrived in Pittsburgh, the BBC pop-up team. And this is their third stop of a six-month journey around the United States. The aim of the BBC's pop-up team, their first mobile bureau, is to explore underreported parts of the U.S. and crowdsource story ideas from the Americans who live there. The team held a community meeting at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and asked people in Pittsburgh what local stories they want to share with a global audience. This special series is produced by Matt Danzico, Benjamin Zand, and Colin O'Malloy. And I've got a little 15-second excerpt that answers this question. Which country, I've already given it away, but which city in the United States has the worst accents? Let's take a look at this little 15-second clip here. Oops, okay, wrong thing. Let's see. Let's try this.
What city in America has the worst accent? And Pittsburgh won.
Really what it is we don't finish any of our words and we smush everything together.
I like it. I love our accent.
Okay, friends, so there you are. And then I had one clip. I don't know how that popped up in there, but that's just a personal photograph I had for joking around with people. Okay, that's it for our Wednesday night report. Let's, like that little photograph showed there, let's zip it for tonight. That's it for this Wednesday evening, God willing, and the creek don't rise, friends. I'll be back again tomorrow night, Thursday night, with today's current news related to the Bible and prophecy right here on Nightcast. I should give a credit there. That little zipper lip thing you saw is from a book I purchased and have been reading. By Karen, what's your last name? And the little book is titled, am I going to blow this title too? I'll straighten this out tomorrow night. I'll do a correction. The book is entitled something like When to Shut It. You know, talking about Femme la Bouche. All right, and I'm going to Femme ma Bouche tonight. That's it again, as I was saying, for this Wednesday night, God willing, creek don't rise, friends. We'll be back again tomorrow night, Thursday night, with the day's current news related to the Bible and prophecy right here on Nightcast. Until next time, this is your host, Stephen Lloyd Gilbreth, saying thanks for joining me. So long, and good night, friends.
You have been watching Nightcast with Stephen Lloyd Gilbreth. Nightcast can be seen Sunday through Thursday nights here on cogtv.org. Tonight's program is also available anytime on demand in the cogtv.org video archive.